Good evening. Now what we are going to do is, today's objective is to understand what big data is and what actually are the different dimensions which we will be using in our trainings, right? And how it is different from, you know, other courses. But before we move there and talk about agenda, let's talk about what big data is and how we are going to handle big data in different architectures. What problems are there which architectures will face when actually they realize that now their architectures are not capable of handling certain situations which have come up because of big data, right? We'll identify what all are the steps that we have to take in order to have transition from current architecture to an architecture where we have to go and adopt big data practices, which includes adopting big data framework, which includes changing the way you do your analytics, introducing data science to it, right? And looking from different perspective on different nature of data and different, you know, type of data which it gets injected in your system, right? Because, you know, sometimes on your data, real-time analytics will be required. You just imagine weather forecasting. There what is required? It's real-time analytics, right? Or log analysis, where every second, you know, log data is getting added to the log files. So there are certain areas where you cannot depend on predictive analysis. You have to go and you have to do real-time analytics, right? So how to identify what type of analytics we have to apply on a particular set of data, which is huge? What is the throughput that is expected, and what is the accuracy level which is expected or which is required for that particular kind of system, right? So in brief, we are going to start with first introduction to big data, and then we will try to pick certain solutions to our architectures, right? So let me start. What is big data? Answer is very simple. I'll not, you know, take much time in order to help you in understanding what is big data. Each and every enterprise will have some application, and that application needs data. That application needs to process something, right? And data needs to be stored somewhere, right? And process needs to get executed. Now, as data increases, need of storage will also grow, right? When more number of clients will try to access the same program, load on the system will increase, right? So to what extent your existing solution or architecture is ready to bear the storage requirement, right? When you did capacity planning of your system, at that point of time, you never realized that your business will grow, you know, with this particular pace. You never realize that you will be acquiring some other company. So their data, their process also need to be adopted. You never realized that social media impact will be to that extent that you have to go and you have to get social media feedback from the users and get the data in your system and do your analytics, provide it to sales team so that, you know, they can use that important information to tune their sales strategy, right? So that is the scenario. Whenever any architecture is not capable of managing data because of its change in some or other dimension, we call that we are into big data problem, right? So you can say big data, scale is high, data is diverse, it's complex, so it needs new architecture, technique, algorithms, and analytics to manage it and extract value from that particular data. Right, so before we start talking about what analytics is all about, let's go and have our own definition. So for that, what I will do is, I'll say that when you are planning, you please plan and ask yourself following questions. Let me make it very simple. What questions need to be asked? First question that you will ask is, what's current capacity of my architecture? When I say capacity, I'm talking in terms of storage, right? What is current storage capacity? And what is predicted in 5 years, next 5 years, right? Assume that your current capacity is something and you have crossed that particular limit. It means your current architecture is not able to manage the big data volume, right? So ask yourself, can my existing architecture handle volume which will come to my storage in next 1 year? If answer is no, it means that you are going to be in trouble, because volume needs to be managed by you, so you need to do something. Second, is my existing architecture capable of understanding various diversified types? Because today, if you see, you have different ways of representing data. You have XML, you have JSON, your data is in form of video, it is in form of audio, it is in form of text, it is in form of, you know, huge number of formats, .docx, .doc, .xl. So is your existing architecture capable of understanding various types? If no, you have to go and you have to get a big data solution for it, right? So three important tests are there that you have to do on your big data or on your architecture. One is scale. Identify whether your existing architecture is capable of managing the volume which is going to be, you know, injected to your system in coming next 1 year. If no, you have to go and adopt, or you need to do some architectural change. What is that architectural change? It can be adding more servers, or it can be adopting some other solution which may be more intuitive, which may be more cost effective. Second is variety of data. As I told you that you have huge variety of data which is getting created today, and believe me, RDBMS is failing to catch up to the pace, right? Now, for example, can you tell me any RDBMS which understands JSON, BSON? These are the formats which are now becoming standards, right? Like JSON is there, similarly BSON is there. There are huge number of formats. So can you store data and retrieve data if it is JSON, BSON in databases? Anyone of you? Karthik, Puneet, Ram, Matthew, Sridhar. You have to do something, right, in order to store data, right? So probably your existing architecture was not planned to handle so many, you know, various type of variety of data, right? So ask yourself, can I handle, is my architecture ready? If not, you have to plan something. Then comes velocity. If you see, data is coming to your system from various sources, right? And it comes with various, you know, speed. So what actually we have to do? We have to be ready for real-time analytics. We have to be ready for predictive analysis, right? We have to be ready to gather data from various sources at various speeds, right? In some use cases, probably you need real-time data streaming, right? So for example, for web analytics, online advertising, if you see, social media, right? Mobile data. You need to have real-time streaming, and your analytics should be based on real-time streaming there, right? So typically when we talk about velocity, you have to identify that what all are the existing features that I expect from my analytics, and if those features, if that particular output that I expect from my analytics is dependent on real-time injection of data, we need to do something. We need to ensure that our architecture supports, you know, fast injection of data. If that capability is missing in your architecture, you need to go for a change, right? In short, these are the four V's that actually are the dimensions which will help you to understand that do you really need to have transition from your existing architecture to big data, right? So you see volume, velocity and variety, complexity, speed and volume. So when I say complexity, it is complexity in handling the data. Volume, you all know, speed, you all know, right? And if you see, dimensions are increasing now. These are different sources from where you will get data. Right. So my first question here is, do you feel that you are in big data trouble only when scale of data is petabyte or terabyte? No, right? It depends.
No.
What is your existing architecture? What is capacity, capability of your existing architecture? If your existing architecture fails, right, to manage the existing volume or predicted volume of next year, you have to think, you have to plan, and you have to align your architecture, right, accordingly. Fine. So this is what defines our big data. Now what we will do, we will talk about big data solutions which are there and how actually you can, you know, in what way they provide you capability. We have 1 hour of session, so probably we will not be able to talk everything here. But yes, we will try to put across all the points which are important. So these are four V's which I was talking about. Veracity is added. Okay. Now if you see, I'm talking from analytics perspective first, and then probably we will move to, you know, architecture perspective. Now if you see 1968 data, importance of organizing data and providing structure to that data was realized, right? So they came up with hierarchical database, then 1970 gave relational databases, right? And then came data warehousing, right? After data warehousing, need was felt of, you know, stream computing. And then came real-time analytic processing to improve business response. So we are going to talk about RTAP, right? Now if you see, it's very important to understand nature of data. So when I talk about nature of data, it is very important to understand that I'm going to do analytics on what? Data at rest or data in motion, right? Because if your data is in motion, it is going to have impact over architecture again, because you have to think about a collection strategy. You need to have data collection strategy. You need to derive data flow strategy. You need to derive processing, storage and delivery strategy, right? Because when we talk about data in motion, characteristics, features will be different of the architecture. It should be high availability. You need to look into horizontal scalability. You need to look into low latency, right? Are you understanding? Let me make it more simple here. If you are not from, you know, big data background, probably this will be a problem. So I'm talking about types of data on which you have to do analytics. See, analytics is based on data, right? Agreed? Everyone, I need some prompts from you because I'm not finding it very interactive.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, one is data at rest. And second is data, you know, in motion. right? So when I talk about data in motion, it is basically real-time streaming. Now, it means analytics that you are going to do on data needs real-time data available. Then only objective of analytics will be met, right? So don't you feel that here you have to be more careful, right? Because data is continuously streaming, so there should be no interruption in consumption of data or in gathering data and then passing it on to the layer which is doing analytics, right? So what I need to do now? Now please understand here that when we talk about data in motion or real-time stream on which you have to do analytics, you need to design your architecture that supports real-time data capture, that supports real-time high availability of your analytics job execution. Your job that gets executed must also, you know, be highly available. There should be no interruption in execution of that program. So I'm just focusing here that just imagine that what kind of architecture you need, right? Fine. So you need to build architecture keeping in mind what is the type of data, and there actually we are going to help you out, right? So data at rest, it means I have, you know, last 10 years sales data with me of a company, and now we are going to do sales analysis, right? So here I have data at rest, that means to say that I have history of data. And my analytics is based on history of data, right? It is not based on data in motion. So don't you feel architecture will be different here, right? Now, question here is, what type of framework we need to adopt that actually provides benefits or that understands data at rest and provides me an architecture which helps me to do analytics which probably can be done on history of data. Second, I need to set up an architecture which supports me to do analytics on data in motion or real-time stream of data, right? So what type of architecture we need to, you know, build here? Let me talk about frameworks which are going to help you in doing this, right? Data at rest means that here you will have characteristics that is write once, read many times. Agreed, right? If history of data is there. I'm saying last 10 years data. So you can go and you can dump it, right? And then you have data in motion that is real time. This is continuous write, right?
Yep.
So it means that I need a framework here which is designed for doing analytics on history of data. So you need here, you know, a framework which can fall under analytical. Big data framework. And here, since you are going to focus on read and write, and sometimes update also, you need something called as operational big data framework. Right? And here itself, I will introduce you some products. Hadoop. Hadoop is an analytical big data framework which provides you certain components that takes responsibility of helping you in storing huge volume of data and also provides you capability of doing analytics on that huge volume which is stored. Right? So I'll come to components of Hadoop a bit later. Now comes operational big data framework. What about this? Have you heard about this? NoSQL? So they are designed for writes of big data, right? So if your need is operational, real-time data analytics, probably we can go and we can decide, you know what, that which NoSQL we have to use, right? So there also we will be discussing as part of course, like which big data, operational big data framework fits in what all scenarios, right? So what you need to do, you need to identify step one, do we need big data solution, right? Step two, identify that you are going to do analytics on what? Data at rest or data in motion? If you are planning to do analytics on data at rest, probably Hadoop and Hadoop ecosystem based products are fine. But if your need is real-time stream analytics, probably you cannot depend on Hadoop. You have to go with what? You have to go with something called as operational big data framework, and obviously NoSQL is one of the choices. Is that clear?
Yes.
Right. Now, since we understand that there are two different type of frameworks, let me give you a brief of, you know, Hadoop and how actually it handles your big data. It will be a very short one because I told you that we have less time to focus on each and everything. And I know that you'll be interested in knowing what actually we are going to do in the course. Now, history of Hadoop is interesting because Google was doing some research on how to manage this big data. They were, you know, someone who came or who were trapped with big data problem in early stages, because of which they released and two papers. One was called as GFS, that is Google File System. They said that conventional file system is not going to help us out in storing and keeping track of our huge chunk of data, which is increasing. And they adopted a programming model called as MapReduce. I mean, these two papers were released in market, and Yahoo actually took it, and they came up with first Hadoop. So you can say first Hadoop was work of Yahoo actually. Right? Then later, you know, research started and everyone came up with some kind of common practice in order to handle big data problem. Right? Later, Apache, it was donated to Apache and it was called as Apache Hadoop, so that everyone can have a common core library on top of which they can build their own products. Right? So I'll talk about Hadoop. Two versions are there, Hadoop 1x and Hadoop 2x. Right? And if you see, architecture is entirely changed. Right? So in short, just to make you aware what Hadoop is combination of two important components. One is HDFS, second is MapReduce. Right? Now what is the role of HDFS? HDFS takes responsibility of providing you a reliable, self-healing file system. Okay? Now why I'm saying reliable, why I'm saying self-healing? Reliability comes because of a basic feature which was adopted by HDFS, and that basic feature is, it says that, see, when you will write some data to me, I will break it into n number of pieces and I will distribute it across my file system, right? And I will also go and I will replicate that data and ensure that I am maintaining replicas also properly. In short, HDFS says that in case if you will lose control over one node, don't worry, I'll have data replicated somewhere else as well. So in case if one node is down, your data is still there. This is why I say that HDFS file system commits you reliability. Is that clear? If someone is asking you why actually and how HDFS provides this reliability, it is because it has basic nature of splitting the data into n number of pieces, storing it, and also maintaining replicas of each, you know, part of that data. Now, why I said it is self-healing, right? I'll explain you this. I feel that you all have time, right? A bit of time is there with all of you to understand this fact? Good. So, my objective is to tell you how it self heals, and why I'm talking about self healing SDFS. This is what is one of the features. Now typically when we talk about file system, Hadoop adopted SDFS, which was borrowed from Google, right? And it works on master-slave architecture. It means that we will have one master and we'll have multiple slaves, right? So let me come and draw something here in order to help in understanding. So I have here one master and three slaves. Now what is responsibility of master? Responsibility of master is to just take request from the client, right? And okay, you want to write something to SDFS, request it to master. And master in Hadoop is what is called as name node, right? No request will directly go to these slaves. All request has to come to master. Now here you have slave, which is called as data node, right? Actual storage of data is on data node. So you can say store part is data node. And all of them are independent boxes. So what is data node? Now I said that, you know, Hadoop is self-healing. So assume that you are writing a file to it. When you write a file to it, you make request to whom? You make request to?
Master.
Master, right? Request goes to master. Master decides that how many parts has to be made for that particular file, right? Because Hadoop says that if your data is more than 64 MB, I'm going to cut it into pieces. What is reason? That also we will be exploring once we move forward. So master says that your file is big, I'm going to split into blocks, right? And where each block will be of 64 MB. So what actually your master does? It splits into blocks where typical size of each block is 64 MB. So assume that your file is 128 MB. How many blocks will be created? Two blocks, right? So master actually splits it and tells that, see, your file is split into two blocks and you can go and store it on, you say, data node 1, data node 2, data node 3. It depends, right? So responsibility of master is to maintain metadata, that what data is stored on what data node. And whenever there is request to write, internally your name node will execute some logic to find out that who all are the best candidates where now fresh data can be written. This is the reason why data nodes will keep on sending their heartbeat information. And that heartbeat information contains their health and their current status in terms of storage and in terms of processing. Right? Am I clear? Who processes the request? Master, right?
Yes. Yep.
Now, assume that you have said master. You have configured master that I just want to, you know, maintain two replicas. I don't want to maintain a default three replicas. So what happens? Each block that you write, now assume that I'm talking about DLK1, right? DLK2, that is block, a replica of block one is there here also. I'm just talking about replica of one block, DLK1, right? And since I said I want two replicas, I'll have two copies, right, of this BLK1, and here I'll have BLK1. You got me? Why I'm replicating it is clear, right? I told you that is basic nature. You can go and control. You can tell your name node that you how many replicas you want, right? But if you want reliability, replicas are needed, right? So here R equal to 2, so I have to go and maintain two replicas. I'll just go and write BLK1. So I have two copies of BLK1 kept on two other data nodes. Is that clear? Write pattern is clear. You place your request to master. Master returns how many blocks are there, and it also returns information about which block has to be written where and how many replicas need to be managed. Now we are going to talk about problem, where you will come to know how it is self-healing, right? Assume that one of the data node is down. What happens? Whenever anyone will ask for the data, you will get the data, right? From BLK1 and BLK2, from data to data node 2 and data node 3, there will be no problem in data loss. But your SDFS internally, asynchronously, right, tries to heal this problem, right? What it does, it tries to go and get, is there any other data node? Because your HDFS will always try to be in balanced state. It will look for balance, right? So when I say balance, it will say if R is equal to 2, in case if one node goes down, I am not in balanced state, right? It will go and see, is there any other data node, right? If it is there, it will immediately go and create a replica of the block to ensure that whatever is number of, you know, replicas which are specified at configuration time, they are always there in your Hadoop ecosystem. This is the reason I told you HDFS is self-healing. Okay? Any question here?
Yeah, just a quick one here. So reliability and self-healing means pretty much the same if that's the case, right?
Yes, if something is self-healing, it will be reliable also, right?
Okay, and again...
But it is not the same. Self-healing is related to problem determination and problem shooting. Reliability also takes into consideration, you know, data loss and rest of the things.
Okay. Okay, yeah. And we can configure the replica as well, right? Saying that if you mention it as 1, then it's just going to create one replica. And if if you say it as 0, it's not going to create any replica.
No, it will not create any replica.
Okay. Thank
you. You can control this replication factor. Not only that, you can control even block size.
Okay, it's not common across all Hadoop systems if that's the case.
Standard is 64 MB for Apache Hadoop, but there are various distributions like, you know, IBM's Big Insight and all, where they have taken 128 MB. Your Cloudera also, you know, 128 MB. That is what it talks about. So 64 MB is the standard which is adopted by Apache Hadoop.
Okay.
Okay, so this is how actually, you know, your HDFS takes care of it. Right? It always tries to balance. Fine. Now let's talk about, okay,
Just a quick question. So in case if the server is busy and say I have a request for the same data node and consider none of them are down and all three are available to me.
So you're talking about load balancing.
Is there a possibility that it, load distribution, is there a possibility that it will hit the backup data instead of actually hitting the data in itself?
No. First of all, you see here, backup data, whatever I'm talking about, you know, maintaining replicas, you don't have that, you know, feature that one will be only backup. Actually, it is not backup. At any point of time, your name node can pick up the data from any one of these data nodes.
Okay, right. Got it. No. Yeah.
Right? When we say backup, it means that it is archived and it is kept somewhere and it needs to be restored. That concept is not there here. Each piece of data, each data node is treated equally by your name node. Whoever is currently available and most appropriate, most near, that is what will be part of the list which will be given to the client to connect and get data.
Oh, okay. Thank you. It's clear enough.
Okay. Fine. So this is just brief about HDFS now. We have concept of SDFS federation and all also, which we will talk later, but we have to move to analytics very soon. Yep. We cannot ignore, you know, analytics now. My data is present. Components which take responsibility of storing my data are name node and data node. I will send my request to name node. Name node will distribute that responsibility of storage, providing me storage to data nodes, and I'll store data. After that, what? After that, you have to go and, you know, write jobs. What is a job? it's nothing but it's a program which goes and tries to do some analytics on existing data. Now, request for analytics or for your job execution will also be made to master. But there will be different component to handle it, you know. And that component is what is called as, you know, job tracker. Right? Job tracker's responsibility is to identify the job, give it a job ID, and then see, can I do, you know, separation of task here, and can I invoke all tasks in parallel? Right? So there actually your Hadoop adopted something called as MapReduce algorithm. Right? It means programming model on which Hadoop operates is MapReduce. Now, why MapReduce and what all are the features of MapReduce? Right? We can discuss at length, but I'll try to, you know, elaborate some important elements of MapReduce. First, MapReduce works on no shared architecture. I'll tell you what is this. MapReduce works on principle of locality. Locality means go where data is and process it. Right? MapReduce talks about execution in parallel. So I'll write here parallel execution. Right? How do we get it? And what do we mean by no shared architecture? No shared architecture means if I want to do a task, assume that I want to execute, select star from customers, and customers is a huge table with huge number of rows. Right? Now, if I submit this query, my, you know, database will treat it as one, it will start one process. Now, instead of this, if I can get a way where I can launch five different, you know, execution processes at the same time to go and get data from database, where each task have his own chunk of, you know, getting the data, it will be faster, right? So yes, there actually parallel execution is required. But when you go with parallel execution, you need to ensure that one task should not depend on other, right? So assume that I submitted a job and we decided that let's split it into n number of tasks and submit all tasks in parallel for execution. We are doing this in order to get better throughput. Now, if one task is dependent on other task, don't you feel that you will not be able to get parallel execution because one task is waiting for other task to, you know, complete. So when you design your analytics, when you derive your algorithm, you need to always focus on when I divide job into n number of equal tasks, each task is independent. They are not dependent on each other. Then only we will be able to get proper power of parallel execution. Is that clear?
Yes.
Good. Now I was talking about components. So see, MapReduce also provides you some components. I'll tell you what are those components. You have job tracker. And each data node will have a TT. I'm calling it as TT because it's task tracker. Right? So on each data node, this is typical architecture that we follow. TT. This also has what? A component called as TT. So now MapReduce also have two components. One is job tracker and second is task tracker. Now whenever you are submitting a file, its file is getting split into n number of blocks and it is getting stored on different data nodes. When you are submitting a job, your job tracker goes and identifies and ensures that it follows data locality principle of Hadoop and assigns job to task trackers of those nodes where data is present. Right? So if data is present on data node 1 and data node 2, you will have two task trackers who will take responsibility of executing that particular job parallelly taking compute power of data node 1 and data node 2. So it's not pull the data in master and then, you know, process it. No. Job tracker assigns responsibility to task trackers on specific nodes in order to do execution in parallel. Right. So in short, if we talk about, if anyone is asking you, like, what is the programming model which is adopted in Hadoop, it's very simple. MapReduce is one of them. MapReduce actually is what? It is based on what? It is based on no shared architecture. It prefers data locality, parallel execution, right? And two-phased, where first phase is map and second phase is reduce, right? So we can talk about it in greater detail when actually we go and we start our analytics, right? Is this clear? Okay, now let me tell you one more thing. Your MapReduce is also self-healing, you know. Assume that when job tracker submitted some tasks, one of the tasks never completed or some problem came and there was an interruption. What will happen? Your job tracker will resubmit that task for execution. And there are number of attempts that you can configure that I want this to be, you know, 3 times, 4 times. So that number of attempts can also be configured by you. Is that clear?
Yes.
Puneet, is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. So you see, when we talk about, you know, data at rest, you have Hadoop, you can do analytics, right? Now what all we are going to talk about, because dimensions are changing. Every problem cannot be actually, you know, resolved or solved by one programming algorithm or model called as MapReduce, right? So what we do, what frameworks we talk when we talk about analytics on data at rest. So to do analytics on data at rest, we are going to talk about, we are going to cover following, you know, methodologies. One is definitely MapReduce. Second is Spark, right? Because Spark, you might have heard, is going to replace MapReduce, right? Why? Because processing of jobs is not less than 20 times faster when you go and adopt Spark methodology, right? But Spark itself is a framework. So we are going to cover MapReduce as well as Spark, right? Because Spark comes with a framework which will help us to understand data in different dimensions, right? You have core Spark, right? You have machine learning, you have Spark SQL, so that you can get data from Informatica, Teradata, or any ERP or EIS for that matter, and you can do analytics, right? Then you have, I told you, machine learning. Then you have graphics. How actually you will represent the same data in a graph form, right? So our analytics of data at rest is going to be this. Yes, Ram, they are implementing Spark and various companies are having transition, you know, from MapReduce to Spark. And you need to understand one more thing. Spark understands MapReduce. Okay? So there will be no portability issues and all. If you want to still retain some of the jobs as MapReduce, you can retain it. Is that clear, Ram? Okay, so that is what we will talk once, you know, time comes. I just told you that these two are algorithms that we are going to use. Okay, so when we do setup of our architecture for data in REST, we will have Hadoop. On top of Hadoop, we will have Spark, right, along with MapReduce and YARN, right? So because of these changes only, you know, you have two versions of Hadoop. One is 1.0, second is 2.0. In 1.0, we had only one way of processing data, and that was MapReduce. But in 2.0, it was decoupled, right? In 2.0, actually this was contributed by Hortonworks, in 2.0 they said that let's decouple. Why MapReduce should do resource management as well as data processing? They decoupled and they said, let resource management be done by Sudan and let data processing be done by some frameworks, where MapReduce is now just one of them. Apart from MapReduce, you have others as well, right? You have, for example, Yarn, you have Page, you have Spark, you have Stringer, right? I'm coming to that, Ram. Is that clear? It was a good question. Thanks. Is that clear? Till here it's clear, right? So let me come and answer question of this. I told that we will be using Spark and we will be using MapReduce, right? Which language we are going to use? Now, you might have heard about a language called as Scala. Have you heard? Have you heard about this? Okay. Now, if you really want to come to data analytics and data science part, you cannot, you know, ignore two languages. One is Scala and second is Python. Right? Because if you see most of the cloud stacks, they are still getting built in, you know, Python. And Scala is treated as language of data science. In this course, we are going to train you on these languages. Python probably for configuration management and all, and Scala for writing your analytics. Ram, does that answer your question? I'll come to R also, Ram. Don't worry. Okay. I'm talking about data at rest as of now, where you need to have this, you know, these languages. You need to know these languages if you really want to contribute. Okay. Is that clear? Okay. Puneet, is that fine?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So this is what is your first part of the content. Now here, when we have transition from Hadoop 1.0 from 1.0 to 2.0, we get two other benefits as well, apart from, you know, data processing benefits. One is, in Hadoop 1.0, if master fails, everything goes for a toss, right? Everything goes. You need to go and immediately have a replicated, you know, name node up. Fine?
Yeah.
That was resolved in Hadoop 2.0. Now in Hadoop 2.0, you can have two name nodes. One name node will be active, another name node will be standby. Okay? So as soon as there is failover, which can be automated failover or which can be, you know, maintenance failover, where manual failover, you just make a note down because you want to add some RAM to it or something, right? So you can do both configurations. You can do manual failover, you can do automated failover. But there are other components also which will come. This is the reason why in this course we have first part kept to help you in understanding the administrative activities that probably you need to do in order to set up your architecture, which contains Hadoop, R, right, which has Spark, which has Sage, which has Stringer, right, various components which are going to be part of analytics. Okay, so this is what will be the first part. Now, second part will help you to understand analytics on data in motion. Right, and there we will introduce you that how actually you can tune your existing big data layer that helps you in doing data in motion analytics. So most of the people actually, when they talk about data science, they talk about, okay, only algorithms. No, it's not only algorithm. You need to understand different architectures on which you are going to do analytics, right? So when data in motion is there, you have to tune your architecture. So you have to find out which NoSQL I should adopt. There are many. You have Cassandra, you have, you know, MySQL, you have Neo4j. There are various NoSQLs which are there in market, right? Then you have to go and set up your distributed streaming data, for which you will explore, shall I go with Storm? STORM, right? And fortunately, your Spark also provides you capability of, you know, handling data in motion by providing you something called as Spark Streaming API, right? So there are huge changes which are coming up. Spark Stream API. So you have a choice. Shall you go with Storm? Because when you go with Storm, this is something which is designed by Yahoo in order to handle data in motion, right? Again, like Ram asked me, but okay, fine, which DSL we need to select? When I say DSL, I feel you understand, domain specific language. I told you Scala, right? So in this second part of our course, we will be exploring how actually we will do analytics on data in motion, right? NoSQL, setting up Storm, evaluating Spark Stream API against Storm, right? And that is what will help you to actually now have proper basic understanding about need of analytics and different architectures which are used in order to support your analytics on both type of data, data at rest and data in motion, right? Now I'm going to come to analytics. Is that clear? Okay, fine. So this part is the last part, and probably I will leave you after this because I think this time is for dinner. So what I'll do is I will just talk about an analytics, what we are going to do. We spoke about setting up the architecture. We spoke about making you aware that how actually you will do basic analytics using MapReduce, Spark, how actually you will do analytics on data in motion, which is Storm and Spark again, right? Now, data science, right? What we will be doing in data science, what technology we have to go and we have to use, right? This course actually is technology agnostic, right? We have adopted R in order to go and do analytics, data science and all, but we have divided it into three parts. One is architecture and understanding data in motion, data in rest. Second part is to focus on data science, where we have to talk about various, algorithms which are there, right? Now, for example, how actually you will have reliability test on the analysis? What is importance of data cleaning? Right, you have to clean the data, right? You cannot just go and do analytics on data whatever is there on HDFS. You have to organize that data, you have to clean that data, you have to make that data ready for your algorithms to work on it, right? So you have to understand that we need to use certain tools in order to clean it, right? That's what we are going to do. After we are clear with how we are going to clean the data, how data in motion and data at rest will work, we will go with advanced analytics. And there, as I told you, two tools are there that we will explore. One is R and second is Mahout, right? And we will be covering 26 different algorithms which are there, which are from different areas, like from predictive analysis, correlation analysis, regression analysis, logistic regression analysis, hypothesis testing, right? So I feel that people who are aware about data science, they might be understanding what I'm talking about. Time series analysis, structure equating modeling, panel data analytics, right? Exploratory factor analytics, and all that we will do using Hadoop, Mahout and R, right? K-mean analysis. So there are various algorithms that we will be covering, and that becomes your third layer. Right, we will be using R and Mahout to do that. Is that clear? Okay, Ram. Now, since we are going to, teach you a language called as Scala, you don't have any prerequisite, right? I feel if you are aware about select star from table and some group by having and all clauses, and if you have worked on a particular language, which can be Java or C++, that's fine, right? Because Scala is a functional programming language, right? So I feel that if people are coming from no knowledge of C++ and Java, upgrading them is rather easy as compared to people who are coming from Java and all. Why? Because they have a tuned set of object-oriented principles in their mind, right? But we are going to take up Scala, complete Scala, which helps you to do fruitful analytics. Okay, right? So we will be doing cloud setup for you, right? In case if you want, we have come up with our own cloud now, where we are going to provide you user ID and password, and you'll be connecting to that particular instance, right? Instead of going to Amazon and doing that. So that is what we are going to use here as well, right? So if you see, basic objective of this course can be divided into four parts. One is understanding architectures and frameworks for big data, helping you to do analytics using some tools like Apache Pig, Hive, right? And also, as I told you, Spark and MapReduce. And then we'll move to learning advanced analytics, where we will go and we will talk about R, Hadoop and Mahout. And most important, we have added visualization also, because whatever analytics you are doing, it will create some data that need to be plotted, right? So we will also use a visualization tool, right? You might have heard about Tableau. Have you heard about Tableau? Right? Or MicroStrategy?
Yes.
No, right. Okay, fine. So that is also part of it. In short, it helps you to understand architecture. It helps you to understand different ways or different standards which have been adopted to do analytics of two different type of data. One is data at rest. Second is data in motion, right? After doing this, we will move learn a language called Scala with a basic of Python, so that we can know, you know, a language of data scientists, right? And then we move to advanced analytics, where we talk about different algorithms for predictive analysis and rest of the things which I spoke about, right? Post that, we will go for visualization. Whatever is your analytics that need to be plotted. So for that also, we will be using a tool to do that, right? So this is what will be the takeaway from this particular course. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Yeah, Ram, Daniel, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so if you have any questions?
Right now, I don't.
Yeah. Okay, so Daniel, are you there?
Niranjan, this is Sridhar.
Yes, Sridhar, tell me.
Niranjan, like, you know, if I learn this analytics, like, you know, how it will help me if I go outside? Like, right now, I don't have any idea about Hadoop. Probably, will that help me directly to go get into this analytics, or not? Do I need to learn?
No. You need not learn Hadoop for this.
Something and
okay. Because objective of a data analytics or data scientist is actually to ensure that you are able to do analytics irrespective of whether that file system is provided to you by Hadoop or it is local file system, right? We take up Hadoop here because it is common practice. So you will be capable enough to install Hadoop, set up the architecture, monitor Hadoop. That capability you will get from this course itself, right? So you need not go and, you know, learn Hadoop.
If you learn this now here and then go out, like, you know, what are the things they will expect from me, and, you know, do I need to have any prior experience on this, or, you know, do I need to have any other, you know, do I need to do any other, you know, suppose, do I need to have any PhD on this to be in data scientist, or, you know, is a regular IT experience is enough?
No, this is enough. I mean to say that today, if you see in market, people have been working on big data only at two different layers, you know. One is to store the data properly, and second, to do basic analytics. So opportunities are going to come up in two other fields now. One is doing rigorous analytics using various algorithms, And second one is plotting the analysis, making the data available to the user. Now, for example, if you go to LinkedIn, now LinkedIn tells you who all have viewed you, right? Mm-hmm. It tells you that, right? Now, that is what is plotting which it is doing. So now enterprises are going to take benefit of the same. We'll be using Tableau RAM.
Okay.
Okay.
So what are the prior experiences that they look into, like, you know, is that just IT experience, or, you know, basically do I need to have any analytics experience prior to this? Or, you know,
actually,
I'm trying to,
understanding of statistics. Okay. And that is what will become the core. Because see, when we talk about this particular stream of data scientists, it is not linked with any other, you know, programming. Because here, you need to be good in three things. One is identifying the data, mining the data, cleaning the data, and then doing analytics depending on what all are the business goals of an enterprise, right? So
I need to know the SQL, right? That's enough for me.
Yes, that's enough for you. If you know SQL, that's enough for you.
Okay.
Okay, I mean to say you don't have dependence.
I'm trying to understand, like, you know, will the course be suitable to me or not? That's the reason I'm asking.
Okay. You need to know basics of SQL, and if you are able to write procedures in SQL, that is added advantage. Rest of the things will be taken care by us. This is the reason I removed Java and we kept here Scala, because that is something which is language of data science now. And you can go and do your, you know, reviews also you can see on Scala and comparative language, right? I'll just tell you one input here. James Gosling, who created Java, you know what he said? He said that if I might have seen Scala, I might have not created Java itself.
Oh.
Right? This is what is the power of Scala, right? You just go and do your research on Scala, right? I'm going to pitch that up here. I want people to, you know, learn Scala, because I have seen market shaping up in that particular dimension, right? And you know what is major benefit of Scala? Just to tell you, Scala programs, once you write, can execute in Java as well as in .NET environment. So rework of analytics will not be required, you know? So if I'm writing a program using Scala, I can compile it in Java, I can compile it in .NET also. Is that clear?
Yeah, Niranjan. Basically, you know, if I learn here all this stuff, whatever you are telling, Spark, Scala, Python, and everything, and then can I go out and export things, you know, without having any analytics experience prior to this?
Yes, because the objective of this is to help you in doing analytics only, right? So we will be talking about algorithms. We will be talking about implementation. We'll talk about which algorithm need to be used in what scenario.
Okay.
Right? So that's what is overall objective of, you know, this training.
Hi, Niranjan.
Yeah.
This is Ram.
Yeah, Ram, tell me.
Uh-huh. I'm wondering, like, you are talking about like 28 algorithms for predictive analytics and exploratory analysis.
Yeah.
So, does it cover, like, I'm just curious, like, neural network, decision tree, SVM, SPD, those algorithms come under
yeah,
the
it will come under this. It will come under this, and some of them we will be covering in Spark as well. Now, if you see Spark, you has a framework component called as graphics. So some of the algorithm we'll be covering there also.
Okay. Since like I have like a decent statistical background, but I know the program only SAS and R. I don't know about Python and other things.
Okay.
I'm wondering whether it is good for me or not. So.
Okay. Great. So if you are from statistical background, you might have understood the power of, you know, these machine learning algorithms and also analytical.
You're just using like regression and those things only, but now new machine learning algorithms like neural network, artificial neural networks, or SVD and other different decision trees are coming. So I see the future and I see the potential. That's why I'm interested in this.
Yeah, great. So So we also have ensured that that is what is covered, and you know, more important here is to practically visualize these algorithms in implementation scenarios. And you know, our objective is to ensure that you should be able to identify that in what use case, right? Mm-hmm. On what data which you have mined, what type of algorithm can be used, right?
Okay.
So, for example, if I ask you, okay, you all use Google Maps, right?
Uh-huh.
So Google Maps is what? What it does? You write source and destination. It has to do what, you know? It has to calculate all possible routes.
Oh, yeah, like the different algorithms you do with it, yeah.
Right? So you can use different algorithms here.
Uh-huh,
now, similarly, yeah. Facebook likes.
Yeah.
Right? So I like you, you like, I like your post, or I like you, right? So
uh-huh.
Facebook will do lots of analysis in order to, you know,
yeah.
identify the taste, the flavor, which a particular, user wants, and suggestions yeah. will be given. Same is the case with LinkedIn. Right?
LinkedIn or Amazon, when you buy something like some details, and it will give you other type of the cleaning products.
Obviously, yes. Now, assume that you bought laptop today, and tomorrow Amazon is sending you again a mail which is related yeah. to laptop. Illogical,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So they will see the consumer's behavior, and n number of algorithms are there that actually helps to get the quickest and the best possible, you know, customer for a particular product.
So what Amazon and Facebook is doing, if I'm understanding you correctly, it is the data in motion or data in stationary? It should be in the data in motion, right?
Some are in data in motion and some are in data at rest. Okay?
Okay. Uh-huh. Okay.
Now, for example, if Flipkart or you say Amazon wants to come up with a promotion, right?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
So it will not only see data in motion, it will see its last 6 months or 1 year or 2 year trend, and then it will decide.
Okay, yeah, got it.
Okay, so guys, I feel that I'm clear from my side. This is what is brief, which we will be doing. We'll be doing all hands-on, right? It will be hands-on driven training. Like, we'll start with installation, setup, and then we'll go and learn Scala, start using a bit of analytics, then slowly introduce algorithms to you at Scala level itself, and then go and use R and Mahout in order to, you know, implement the data science part.
So,